Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
It is my pleasure to welcome Chantal. So Chantal Keller is a postdoc at Emerson and RIA, and she will be working in Cambridge for 6 months from September. And she's going to tell us all about how to integrate Coq and SMTs.
Thank you for the invitation and the introduction. I start with a few words about me. So I did my PhD at École Polytechnique under the supervision of Benjamin Werner. Then I did a postdoc in Aarhus, in Denmark, working on a slightly different topic. And I'm now a postdoc at MSA in RIA in Paris, as Cedric said. And I'm working on the design of F-star and related stuff. So today I'm going to present the work I did during my PhD, which consists in integrating external SMT solvers inside Coq, using proof witnesses in order to reduce the proofs in Coq. So I start with a bit of motivation. So we have mainly two kinds of provers that can use computers. On one side, you have interactive theorem provers, in which you have to interact with the system in order to convince him that a proof is indeed correct. And on the other side, you have automatic theorem provers, in which you just give what you want to prove, and then the prover will answer, hopefully, yes or not, if it's not provable or something. But the problem is that you don't really know why this theorem is indeed correct. So I like to make both systems communicate in order to gain in the interactive theorem prover more automation and in the automatic theorem prover more safety. So in my PhD, I took as an interactive theorem prover Coq, which is developed by INRIA mainly, in order to do this kind of communication.
What do you mean by safety?
I mean that, okay, in an interactive theorem prover, most of the time you have a small kernel that rechecks all the proofs, whereas in automatic theorem prover, it's a very huge code, and it's less safe in the sense that you are not sure that the proof is indeed correct. So I would like, in the end, everything to be rechecked by the small kernel of the interactive theorem prover. So there are mainly two approaches. The first one is to certify the automatic theorem prover, which means that we prove inside the interactive theorem prover all the code of the automatic theorem prover. So this is nice because in this case, you can do the proof once and for all, and you have a full certified ATP. You can also prove that the ATP might be complete in some sense. But the drawback is that it's quite hard to prove the correctness of a ATP with full heuristics and things like that. And moreover, it's not flexible in the sense that once you have proved your ATP, if you change something inside the ATP, then you have to redo lots of proofs in order to prove again that it's correct. The second solution is to use a certifying ATP, which means that you use an external ATP that returns a proof witness that can be rechecked. And usually, it should be simpler just to recheck the proof witness rather than to prove the whole correctness of a prover. It's also more flexible because if the ATP changes, as long as it returns the same kinds of proof witnesses, I can reuse everything that I've done without changing anything. The drawbacks are that we don't have a certified ATP, so we have to recheck everything each time. But this shouldn't be a drawback regarding the time. You can also not formally prove the completeness, because of course the ATP may return something which is wrong, but you have no means to know that a priori. So in my thesis, I choose this solution. I use an external ATP that returns the proof witness, and in Coq, I wrote a certified checker for such proof witnesses. So this is my the outline of my talks. I will first give a general overview of how to to do such a communication using coq with external powers. Then I'll explain the main part of the checker, and then I'll go into details in what I call small checkers to check the separate theories coming from SMT solvers. I'll say a few words about efficiency before concluding. So the heart of my work is a certified checker written in coq, which means that in coq I want a checker which is a program that takes two arguments, the formula we want to prove, and the certificate that should prove the formula, and it returns a boolean. And the idea is that this boolean, when this boolean is true, then the certificate is indeed a proof of the formula. So there are the correctness is stated as follows. I define an interpretation function from formulas into coq booleans, and the correctness says that, just what I said, if the checker returns true, then the interpretation of the formula is a valid coq formula. So here we see that there is no completeness. In particular, when the checker returns false, I just don't know anything about the formula. It might be that the formula is not true, or it might be that the certificate is not a correct proof, but I just don't know. I'm interested in here only on correctness. The nice thing with this checker, since it's written in coq, is that we can, it's a full ML program, so we can extract it to OCaml or to any functional programming language and use it in standard programming language. So this is the heart of the whole system. And then if we want to check actual or concrete certificates coming from concrete SMT solvers, the idea is to write parsers for the input and for the certificate and to plug them into my certified checker. So in this schema, the input parser is not certified, but actually here the input taken by the coq checker is really close to the input of the SMT solver, so the input parser is mostly the identity function. So I think it's not a problem if it's not certified. And on the right side, the proofreadness parser is not certified, but this is not a problem since I said there is no completeness in my schema. I'm just interested in correctness, and this is not relevant for correctness because if the proofreadness parser is not correct, then it will just give me wrong certificates, but I won't prove something wrong in the end. I just lose in completeness.
So yes? What is the format of the problem?
So, well, the SMTlib format, SMTlib. Yes. So it's really interesting that we don't care about the correctness of the parser, the witness parser, because it means that I can do a lot of computation in order to pre-process the witnesses, to put them in some special form, and it's not a problem if I don't need to certify this part of code. So here the trusting base is, of course, coq, plus the input parser, as I said, but it's mostly the identity, plus the interpretation function I showed on the previous slide, because, of course, the correctness of the whole thing is proved up to this interpretation function. But once again, it's mostly the identity from SMT formulas into the coq standard formulas. As I said, I can write any preprocessor and I don't need to certify this code. In fact, what I wrote is written in OCaml. So it means that I can very simply use different kinds of proofreadnesses. I just have to write a preprocessor into my format of certificates in order to be able to plug another kind of proofreadnesses, and so another kind of SMT solver. Which, of course, is interesting because you don't have to write coq code or coq proofs.
Sorry.
Yes?
Did you have to have the input parser interpretation as a trusted base?
So in this schema where I just want to check that the proofreadness is indeed a proof of a problem, yes. I have to relate the initial problem with what is taken as an argument in the coq function. But, well, it's just the identity, okay? I just transform the SMTlib formula into the coq corresponding embedding of the formula.
You see, if you could have a formula, then you could have something external who could use something that it claims as a witness. You could check the two.
Yes, so if the formula comes from a cock goal, of course, then the input parser won't be in the trusted base. But here, I'm just presenting the way to check the certificates. But of course, if the formula comes from Cox, then the input parser won't be anymore in the trusting base.
Yeah? So the alternative would be to write the entire semantics of SMTlib in calc, to take the SMTlib input as just a bit string,
yeah,
and write gruelingly some parser.
Yeah, anyway, there's always a bit of glue somewhere. So I don't think it really matters if this glue is just a string or... Yeah, just reading the file and changing the constructors into the corresponding constructors.
So, I mean, practice, if you just want to integrate something into cop, you're going to print the thing from cop as well, if you want it for the external.
Yes, of course. So, if I want to use the ATP as a cop tactic,
yes,
I'm taking the cop goal and I'm sending it to the SMT solvers, and then the input parser is not in the trusting base anymore.
But even if you write all the formula in calc as propositions, there's also a reification phase that's in the trusting phase.
So, well, I have a slide in the end of the talk about this. If it comes from the calc goal, nothing is in the only calc is in the trusting phase. Okay, no input parser, no reification. They are all they don't belong to the trusting phase. Yeah.
Isn't mandate calculus to use, right? So different
provers
have different inference
rules. Well, I come to this later to explain which is the format of my certificate and how I check them.
I wanted to tie up with Josh's remark that it might be that even if you can interpret SMTlib in calc, then you're still left with possibly a Babel situation of different provers, different inference rules. So then, still need to be interpreted. So if a inference rule would need to be interpreted.
Yeah, but the model theory is specified.
Anyway, if I want to check, if I'm an SMT user and I just want to check the answers, then I use the schema and the input parser is in the trusting base. But mostly the identity. Okay, so in the case of SMT calc, what is the input and what is the certificate? So the input is a first order formula found in a combination of theories that are handled by SMT calc. And as a certificate, so I want to prove that the formula phi is provable, which means that it's equivalent to proving that the negation of phi is unsatisfiable. So as a certificate, I'm going to take a proof by resolution of the unsatisfiability of not phi, which I'm going to explain what it means. So the resolution rule is really standard. I have a clause which is a disjunction of literals, where a literal is either a variable or its negation, or an atomic proposition in some theory, or its negation. And the resolution rule just takes two clauses, one with the atom X and one with the negation of X, and builds a new clause that does not contain X. What I call a theory lemma, a rule in one single theory that can be applied in the reasoning. So it can be it's a very general sense. I mean, this is a rule in the CNF theory. If I have a formula chi and a formula psi, then I can deduce chi, for instance. Or it can be very general. I can say that phi is a valid formula in the linear integer arithmetic theory as long as it's a valid conjunction of atoms in this theory. So what I call theory lemmas can be very general. It just depends on how I prove, how I check each theory in the end, which I say later in the small checker parts. And this is an example of a certificate. So I have the conjunction of two clauses, and I want to prove that they are unsatisfiable. So here, I have an implicit conjunction, and here I have an explicit conjunction that belongs to the theory of putting formulas into CNF. So for instance, I can break this conjunction using the theory of CNF. I can have a theory lemma in linear integer arithmetic, because this is a valid clause in linear integer arithmetic. And everything is plugged using resolution. So the interest of the design of this certificate is that any piece of the certificate belongs only to one theory, which means that in my code checker, I don't have to combine theories. They will be combined by resolution in some sense. But the parts belonging to each theory is really separated in the certificate. Okay, so this was a general overview of my certificates and my formulas. And now I'll go into the details to explain how I can check them. So the idea is to have a very modular checker, and this is related to what I just said. I can separate the theories, so I can plug very easily checkers for independent theories. And I can combine them using what I call the main checker. So the main checker is the thing that takes the input and the certificates, and it will split the certificates into small parts that are going to be sent to the small checker depending on the theory I want to check, and everything is combined in order to build the result. So as I just said, the small checker is something that takes a line of the certificate or a node in the tree as arguments and an input clauses, and it returns a clause which is implied. In particular, when there are no input clauses as argument, as in linear arithmetic, as I presented, then it means that the return clause is a tautology in linear arithmetic. The main checker maintains the whole set of clauses, and its role is just to dispatch the pieces of certificates and the sets of clauses to the small checkers and to combine them. So the correctness of the whole thing relies on the correctness of the small checkers, which are really independent from each other. They just share the representation of formulas. Just to give an example on my running example, I'm going to explain how the main checker works. So as I said, it maintains a set of clauses. So I have internally a set of clauses. And I start by putting into my set initial clauses, of course. And then I'm going to call the small checkers on each piece of the certificate. So here, for instance, I want to check that this is a tautology in linear arithmetic. So I'm going to call the linear arithmetic checker and say, prove me that this is a tautology. And it'll say yes. So I can put this clause into my set of clauses. And the invariant of the whole thing is that all the clauses in the set of clauses are implied by the initial clauses. Here, because it's a tautology. Then, for instance, I want to compute this resolution. So I'm going to send the two input clauses to my resolution checker. And it's going to give me back the resolvent. So I can put it into my set of clauses, since it is implied by what is in the set of clauses. And I can go on. This I send to the CNF checker, and he says that it's correct, so I can put it in my set. And in the end, I call the resolution checker on the two remaining clauses. It gives me the empty clause. And the last check is just to check that the empty clause belongs to the set of implied clauses, which is the case in this example. So this is a very simple presentation of how to check such certificates. Of course, this is not really efficient, because the set of clauses, if I have a concrete proof coming from something interesting, the set of clauses is going to be very, very, very big. So I don't want to use standard sets. Instead, I'm going to pre-process the certificate in order to see how many clauses I have to remember at each step of the process. So for instance, here, I can realize that only three clauses are alive at the same time, which means that instead of a set, I can use an array containing three cells, and I'm going to update the cells of the array when I compute new clauses. So as before, I start by putting into the array the original clauses, And then, for instance, if I still want to compute this clause, I'm going to call the linear arithmetic checker. It's going to say yes, so I can put it in my array. And now, if I want to compute this resolution, I send the two initial clauses to the resolution checker. It gives me the resolvent, and I can update in the array, for instance, the second cell, because I'm not going to use anymore what was the clause that was present in this cell. And I still have the invariant that everything which is in the array is implied by the initial clauses, but it's just that it takes very less memory to represent all the set of clauses. And of course, I can go on. Here, I can use a CNF checker and put it in my in the first cell of my array. And then in the end, I can put the empty clause in my array. And I still check that in the end, I have the empty clause in my array. Since it is implied by the initial clauses, then I know that the formula isn't satisfiable. So this is just one example of the improvements that are inside SMTcock in order to be efficient, both in time and in memory. And this is possible because, as I said, I can pre-process the proof witnesses as much as I want because this is I don't have to trust pre-processing. So this is an example of pre-processing. When I take my proof witness, I first compute the number of clauses that are alive at the same time, and I assign a cell in the array to each of the clauses in order to do this improvement. And this is at no cost because I don't have to trust the preprocessor. Okay, so I guess, yes?
So you're only interested in unsatisfiable first order formulas?
Yes, so I want to prove some formulas which is equivalent I want to say that some formula is a tautology which is equivalent to proving that its negation is unsatisfiable. If I want to check satisfiability in Coq, it's really easy because I just have if the SMT solver can give me an assignment of the variables that satisfy the formula, in Coq, I just have to replace the variables by their assignment, and in Coq, it's possible to let the system compute and check in the end that I indeed obtain the true in the end.
So no matter what theories are there?
No, well, the theory must be implemented in Coq somehow, but the check is very easy because I just let Coq compute. So if I want to prove satisfiability in Coq, it's not really a problem. It's more complicated with unsatisfiability, which I think is more interesting because it's equivalent to provability. Yeah.
So it's not no cost at all to just have an array, right? You need to remember which cells you can update at any step in the proof or something. So you need to have some narrative of that cell.
So in fact, my certificate doesn't look like this. It looks like a list of commands. And each command says, so for instance, for the last resolution, the command says, take the two input clauses which are at cells 3 and 7, give them to the resolution checker, and put the result into cell 9. So after pre-processing, it's a list of such commands, the certificate. It's not a tree anymore. And of course, I can do sharing if I can share some parts of the certificate if they return the same clause.
Do you something like a register machine to run the protocol through this machine?
I don't know exactly what you mean by register machine.
An abstract machine based on a register rather than a stack.
I just use arrays, standard arrays, I mean, which are now implemented in Coq. But yes, I can try to do something different. This would allow to compute also the terms in this way, but no, for the moment, no.
So is the information that is often in the resolution proof that an SMT solver gives you enough to determine sort of this command language about where to update them, or do you have a lot of work to find that out?
So this is a good question. So this are my certificate, which means this is input of the Coq checker. And when I have a concrete proof witness coming from some SMT solvers, sometimes I have to recover some information in order to be in this certificate in the end. But again, this is pre-processing, so it can be written in any language. But yes, still, with some SMT solvers, I do have to recover some information that are losing. No more questions on this part? Good. So what I explain is the main checker, which is the part of the code that dispatches the pieces of certificates. And I'm going to give an overview of the small checkers for each supported theory in SMTCOC. So currently in SMTCOC, we have mainly five theories. So as I said before, a theory it's a very large term. Okay, by a theory, I can mean different things. Because here I can consider resolution as a theory because it can be handled by a separate small checker unrelated to the rest. So I have small checkers for resolution, CNF computation, linear integer arithmetic, of course equality of an interpreting functions, and something a bit more complicated, which are silent simplifications, because in SMT solvers, especially at the beginning of the reasoning, but also inside, sometimes there are silent simplifications. So in this case, I need to discover how to check these simplifications efficiently. So I'm just going to present how each small checker works, because we will see that we can have very different approaches depending on the theory, but it's not a problem since all the theories are independent from one another. So let's start with resolution chains. So if I take my running example, I can see that in the resolution part, I just need to know the content of the atoms of the theory. So here, for instance, I just need to know that this is a negation of this, but I don't care that it's x is greater than 7. So for the resolution checker to be efficient, I don't want to look inside the atoms. I want a representation of atoms and of terms that allow just to know very quickly that this is the negation of this. So to do so, I entirely hash the atoms and the formulas, which means that I have an array representing all the atoms. And in each cell, I just have one constructor applied to many atoms that relate to previous cells in the array. So for instance, this formula is just the atom number 5 in the array, where 5 is a conjunction of atoms number 2 and 3, and so on. So this is maximally hashed, and the idea is that, well, if I don't want to look inside the atom, I just stop in one cell and I don't continue the process. So this is for the atoms, and now to represent literals, I use this ID, which is 2i corresponds to the positive literals associated to the atoms at place A, in the cell number i, and 2i plus 1 represents the negative literal associated to it. And with this representation, it's very easy to check when a literal is a negation of another one, because it's just that it's plus 1. And with this representation, I can do lots of computation very fast, because, for instance, yes, I have the bitwise operation in order to compute most operations. So it can be very fast to do resolution. If I come back to my example, so I have the array representing the formula, which is hashed. And this tree now simply becomes this. And here, for instance, to compute the resolution, I just recognize that 9 is the opposite of 8 and gives me 5 and so on. And in fact, I just don't need to know this array at all, okay, to compute resolution. So yes.
Is the reason not to use just I and minus I?
Well, I'm using unsigned integers.
Oh, you have some cock theory.
Yes, yeah. But if I had signed integers, I could use I and minus I. Well, this is just a matter of design. So I can compute resolution fastly like this. So a clause is just an ordered list of unsigned integers representing the literals, and I just go into the list in order to find the resolvent in the end. And I do not need to know the hash table of the atoms at all.
So it sort of seems that the hashing itself is a small part of the cost of the whole.
Yes, so hashing is also performed by preprocessing.
Yeah.
So you don't have to trust it.
Outside of Coq?
Outside of Coq, okay. Yes.
I mean, if that doesn't work, there's no way that the SMT solver will ever have found a proof. If you can't hash those terms, then you're screwed. I think you're dead a long time ago. But do you have to keep all of the whole set of terms all the time? Or can you keep some subset of it?
Well, so as I said, for the resolution, for instance, the resolution checker doesn't know about the set of atoms at all.
But you have to have the whole set for the,
yes,
the certificate at some
point
inside.
Yes, so it could be an improvement to forget it. But I think it's at the cost of safety because, in Coq for the moment, everything is stored in memory at the beginning of the process. So the set of atoms and the list of commons which represent the certificate. And then I compute and I can forget intermediate computations, but not the initial stuff. But we can imagine doing otherwise, but it's at the cost of safety somehow. Yeah?
It's just a silly comment. You really could turn this into a video game and people wouldn't realize that they were doing proof.
Okay, so this was for resolution. And I get talk about CNF computation. I guess you all have imagined what I can do. In fact, the hash of the atoms and the hash of the formulas represent set invariables, which means that I can have very fast CNF computation for free. So the idea of set invariables is the following. For each subterm of the formula, I introduce a new variable name, and I introduce some rules to explain the meaning of this name. So in this example, for instance, here, I say F1 is equal to A and B. So from F1, I can prove A and B, and from not F1, I can prove not A or not B. So these are kinds of projection rules. And these are more complete tautologies, which are just the same, but presented as tautologies. So the idea of CNF computation is just to know that these rules are true, given the names given to subformulas. But of course, as I said, my hashed array is already giving names to each subformula. So for instance, if we look at the fifth cell, the rules are just the following. I say that A of 2 and A of 3 implies A of 2, which is translated with my representation of literals to 10 implies 4, because this is 2 times 5 and this is 2 times 2. The other one is 10 implies 6, because it's 2 times 5 implies 2 times 3. And the negation of the whole thing is 11 implies 5 or 7, I guess. You have understood what I mean. So the CNF checker just has, so for instance, to check that this rule is indeed correct, I just have to go in the fifth cell and check that 2 is indeed a component of the conjunction which is inside the cell. So once again, it's very efficient because it's just one call in the array of atoms. Okay. This corresponds to this rule. Okay, so now let's go to more interesting theories like linear integer arithmetic. And in this case, I'm reusing some part of Coq, which is an efficient tactic to prove linear arithmetic goals into Coq, which is called Micromega. And actually, Micromega works exactly as SMT Coq. The idea is to call an external solver that produces a certificate and then to check it efficiently inside Coq. And it was really easy to use for SMT Coq, because I just had to translate my representation of formulas into the micro omegas representation, which is very close. During preprocessing, I called the external solver to get the certificate, the micro omega certificate. And during checking, I called the micro omega checker written in Coq. So in this case, since I already had a decision procedure in Coq, I don't require the SMT solver to give me detailed certificates because there are already efficient procedures in Coq. And it's really easy to integrate, it's just some gluing. Very easy. Simplifications now, it's a bit more complicated. And the idea that we may have silent simplifications inside the SMT solver. For instance, we can flatten connectives like AND or OR. We can put the formula in some canonical form, for instance, saying that X is greater than 2. We replace silently it by X is smaller than 2. 2 is smaller than X, and so on. And usually there is no certificate. So the problem is that given two terms, I have to prove that their interpretations in Coq are equivalent. And there are mainly two approaches to do this. The first one is a syntactical approach, which means that I have the formula represented as a hashed formula, but it can be seen as a tree, and I just run inside the trees in order to check when simplification might appear. So for instance, if on the one end I have a node which represents something is smaller than another thing, and in the other one I have greater instead, then I can continue by switching the two branches starting from this node. So it's very useful, the syntactical approach is useful to check things like flattening, associativity, or just rewriting of linear equations. And it's very nice because we can mix theories. As you can see, we can mix, let's say, CNF or logical formulas, simplifications, with linear arithmetic. So it's very useful to mix theories. The problem is that we cannot prove something more complicated because, for instance, we cannot prove that these two formulas are equivalent. So we also use a semantical approach, which means that we send the two formulas we want to prove equivalent to one of the small checkers, and we ask it to prove that they are indeed equivalent. And in this case, I can prove more complicated equivalences, but I cannot mix theories. So the idea in the end would be to mix both in order to be able to prove at the same time flattening and such a kind of ring simplifications, for instance. So this was the idea, yes?
So in the certificates that you get back from SMT solvers, do you actually see silent simplifications that don't easily decompose into a sequence of theory-independent simplifications?
The problem is that I have to recover from which theory the simplification might come from without much knowledge. So for instance, to prove this equivalence, I have to guess that it's a linear arithmetic equivalence by looking at the symbols in the formulas and things like that. So no, it's not complicated, but I cannot ensure that it's complete somehow.
So far, you are never using any Coq tactics that would already do some of those for you. It's just not the right.
Linear arithmetic, I use micro omega.
Yes, but for.
For example,
you look.
For this example, I'm going to send it to micro omega. So I reuse the small checkers depending on the theory. And if the theory is linear arithmetic, of course, I call micro omega. Yep.
Question is similar to the previous question. Can you have the SAT solver generate more returns to help some of your small checkers, like this one or the CNF computation?
Perhaps, but this is not my job. I should have said at the beginning. So I'm not implementing an SMT solver. I use existing ones, and I try to do what I can with the proof fitness and the return.
How hard is it to make it generate more returns?
This is a question to ask to SMT people. I guess it comes from a time cost during proof search.
When I have asked for more things being put into the witnesses, there tends to be a lot of pushback. it's hard to generate them fast. So they are the way that they are for very carefully chosen reasons, by and large.
So a different approach is for the solver to produce a called proof, right? So that there's a prover that does that. And that would, in a sense, take out the middleman, because you rely entirely on the cop checker directly, so the parser, the cop parser and cop checker, rather than having a pre-validated checker. What are your thoughts on that?
So,
is it scalable? Does it make sense?
So I think it's not a good idea for two reasons. So first, it will be very complicated to generate a cop script from an SMT solver, because the reasoning is completely different. And
the way you do that is they embed the calculus inside COP, so you have a COP theory with the calculus. And then the script consists entirely of, they use LTEC macros, so the script is obviously not human readable, as is mostly the case with automatically found proofs. But they do, at least with respect to the calculus they use, they have completeness, because they embed their system, by system I mean system of logic, not the program, inside COG. So then there's a sequence of tactics to evolve the proof state and to ultimately find a verification.
Okay, well, anyway, you don't have completeness because you are not sure that the script which is generated is indeed correct. So perhaps you are more complete, but not so much.
So are we pointing to a syntactical process, possibly a syntactical problem in the script?
Yes,
or
for instance.
Or the implementation of the process that produces it?
Yes, for instance. And, well, the second reason I prefer my solution is that I think it's more efficient, because the checker is just a COG program which belongs to the ML subpart of COG, and just doing some computation. And in the end, I check that it returns true, and the computation can be very fast in COG. So this is a process which is called computational reflection, and I think it's more efficient than standard COG scripts.
So the proof produced by the script is likely to be gigantic and just to explode the system if you follow his approach.
Yes, or anyway, it will be less efficient. Okay. So just one remaining theory, which is equality of an interpreting function. So it's a theory relying on these two rules, which are congruence rules, which means that if x is equal to y, then I know that f of x is equal to f of y, whatever f might be. And I know that the predicate p of x is equivalent to the predicate p of I, whatever they might be. And moreover, I know that equality is symmetric and reflexive and transitive. And it is widely used in SMT solvers, of course, to share the equalities between the different theories. So it can be really easy to check them in COG. In my certificate, I used more detailed certificates in which I know which rules are applied at each step. So I have congruence for functions and predicates, as I said, which are expressed as tautologies. And I have a rule for transitivity. And in each of these rules, the equalities are taken modulo symmetry and reflexivity, which means that it handles the whole theory of uninterpreted functions. Anyway, I could have written a complete decision procedure. So I think it's not difficult. But I let the preprocessor do this decision procedure, so I don't have to prove it, and I have a more detailed certificate. Anyway, the idea here was to show you that I can use completely different techniques for the small checkers and combine them using my main checker very easily. I just have to prove the correctness of each part of each small checker and get the correctness of the whole. So here I had a large notion of theory, as I said, and I can, for instance, have different small checkers that overlap for some theories, For instance, I can imagine writing a small checker that handles both equality of an interpreting function and linear arithmetic. And then I can choose at each step the most appropriate small checker, and as long as it does the job, they can all cohabit. Okay, so I'm just going to say a few words about efficiency, but we talked about this a bit before. So in addition to for the SMT solvers to finding the proof, so now it requires it to return a proof witness, a bit detailed, of course. Then I have to pre-process it, as I said, in order to compute the number of cells of the array and things like that. And I have to do the checking in coq or in the extracted checker. And I didn't put the times because it's boring, but I have benchmarks that show that finding the proof and generating the proof witness takes a lot of time, more time than pre-processing and checking. Which means that as long as I use an SMT solver that returns the proof witness, it's not a bottleneck to check the proof witness using my system. And it's also faster than the state-of-the-art certifying SMT solvers and certified SMT solvers. Yes?
How does the time of reformatting the certificate compare to the time of calling the SMT?
I don't really know. It just
depends. That typically is the time of running the SMT.
Well, yes.
Something
that I didn't say. So these benchmarks have been made for the veriT SMT solver, which returns really detailed certificates. So in this case, preprocessing is quite fast because we don't have to recover much proofs. Of course, if I use another SMT solver that gives less details, then the time for preprocessing will be greater. But perhaps the time for the generation will be smaller. So. Well, it's a balance, and I don't feel a theoretical idea of the good balance between the two.
The state of the art for the SMT solver, do you mean the Z3 integration as well?
No, I mean certified SMT solvers like Ergo in coq, as you might know. So it's an SMT solver written in coq and proof correct in coq. It compares well to what has been done in Isabel. So I did benchmark, and it's almost the same times. But the approach is different from Isabel, of course, because in Isabel, they redo the proofs using Isabel's small into the way it's done in the kernel of Isabel. Whereas in my approach, I use computational reflection, so it's a bit different. Okay, so let's conclude. So I presented this empty coq, which is an efficient checker for a general notion of certificates. On top of it, I give preprocessors for the SAT solver zChaff and for the SMT solver veriT, and I'm currently writing those preprocessors. I can also use them as coq tactics, and as I said, it's modular at many levels. Here, I can easily plug new small checkers if I have them. And here, I can use another SMT solver as long as I can write a preprocessor for it. So I showed, for instance, how to encode tableaus and BDDs reasoning into my kinds of certificates. So it's not implemented, but I showed how the reasoning can be encoded. And so I could plug tableaus or BDD solvers very easily. We can also think about first-order provers. As they use also resolution, we can think that it can be quite easily encoded in my certificate. So there were many questions at the beginning about the trusting base. So I can also use my checker indeed as a coq tactic. In this case, the formula comes from a coq goal that I have to reify. I give to the external prover, and I check in the end the certificates given by the external prover. And of course, in this case, the trusting base is only coq, because all the blue parts are not proved in coq, but I don't care. In the end, if some of this blue part is incorrect, then I just fail, but I don't prove something wrong. I can also return counterexample if the SMT solvers give me assignments in the case of satisfiability. once again, is modular in terms of proofiness. So the perspective of SMT Coq, so you can download it here if you want to play with it. And so as Cedric said, I'm going to be here from September to February. And during my visit here, I'm going to work on plenty of things, but regarding SMT Coq, I'd like to integrate it with some tools that use SMT Server, like for instance FSTAR. And of course, to do this, I'm working on improving the system in order to handle new solvers like Z3, which is used by FSTAR, and new theories, for instance, quantifiers, because they are mostly used in the proof of programs, as FSTAR does. But I have other perspectives that I'd like to do one day. For instance, improving the tactic, because it's quite hard to know in the tactic which lemmas to send to the provers and things like that in order to actually prove the goal. I like, why not, to mix SMT solvers. For instance, when I had that stream, one of my ideas is to perhaps use another solver in order to find some parts of the reasoning that would be missing. And I like to use SMT Coq to design new decision procedures, for instance, that use bit blasting inside Coq. And I guess I'm done. Thank you for your attention.
What difficulties do you anticipate to encounter when you come to integrate Z3? So you mentioned that you can integrate, I think you said you can integrate any SMT solver as long as you can write a preprocessor for them. Do you anticipate any sticky bits with Z3?
So the problem is that the proof fitness is less detailed than the one I used so far. So I think the preprocessor will be a bit more complicated, especially regarding simplifications. For instance, in the rewrite rule, rewrite rules are applied lots of times and they correspond to simplifications. So perhaps I'll have to improve the simplification checker. Anyway, for the theories I handle, I think it could be straightforward because the more complicated theory is linear arithmetic and I already have a full decision procedure, so it should be okay. But then I like to integrate other theories, for instance, for data types, and then I have to write a new checker for these theories.
So if I understand correctly, the preprocessor, it's like a realization, so it's a realization of an embedding from the logic of Z3 or from the calculus that Z3 uses into this intermediate logic that you use, which is then itself interpreted in Coq, as it were.
Yes, so in Coq there are mainly two embeddings, one representing the formulas with the hashed array of atoms and things like that. And these formulas are interpreted into Coq. And then the certificate is also embedded, but it's not really interpreted. I just prove that the correctness of the checker, saying that if the checker returns true, then the interpretation of the formula is valid Coq formula.
So will you need to add more commands to that language that you described earlier? Or is that kind of shifted to the preprocessor that did interpret the differences in terms of the existing language?
So as long as I don't handle new theories, I think it's just a matter of preprocessing. If I want to add new small checkers, then I'll add some lines corresponding to each small checker.
So I have a question about the size of the certificate.
Mm-hmm.
In general, is it problematic or does it scale up indefinitely as far as you can tell? The reason I'm asking is one of the advantages of having certified SMT is that
yes,
you can keep all of that implicit.
So I can handle the benchmark I did are on industrial benchmarks. So the certificates are already huge and I can check them in. So the timeout was 5 minutes, but most of the time I can check them in 10 seconds or something like this. I think that as long as the prover can do the proof, then it's not the size of the certificate is not really a bottleneck. Because even if the certificate is exponential, finding the proof is also exponential. So, So Benjamin Grégoire and Pierre-Yves worked on very large certificate for the R2 conjecture, and they changed a bit the way Koch is doing computation, but they could check very fastly this kinds of certificate, and it was 10 gigabytes, I guess.
So is your experience that Micromega is sort of fast enough, or I mean, it could well be that ends up being actually rather slower than the original SMD solver or whatever procedure it used. Is that potentially a source of problem later on?
So yes, I know that Micromega has some very bad cases in which it just crashes, but I didn't reach those bad cases. On the benchmarks I used, yes, I didn't see any problem.
Okay.
Yep.
So in SMTlib, the theories are defined very semantically, where they say, here's the class of models of the signature that are allowed. Do you have to actually reflect that into Koch? Because some of these theories are not even finally axiomatizable, although maybe in Koch they are finally axiomatizable. They're not first order finally axiomatized.
So the idea is that I have a deep embedding in Koch of the formulas of the theory, or the atoms of the theory, and then I translate them into one Koch axiomatization of the theory. And of course, if it's a bit different, then it might raise problem when I want to prove the correctness of the small checker. Because when I prove the correctness of the small checker, I prove that the interpretation of the formula is valid. So if the interpretation does not correspond exactly to the SMT limit interpretation, it might be difficult to do the proof.
Because at some level, I mean, the notion of validity in SMTlib is it's valid in all models of the signature, as well as all interpretations for the variables. And I'm wondering whether you have to actually reflect that sort of two levels of universal quantification in the Koch formulation, or whether you can give just one axiomatization?
By writing the interpretation function, I choose one model.
Uh-huh. So there could be things that are valid in that model that are not invalid in other models.
Yes.
So kind of theory I'm thinking of.
Say reals, there are non-standard reals.
I didn't talk about reals because reals in Koch are quite... Of course, they are not mathematical reals. So, well, it depends, but...
Well, SMT, the theory of reals are mathematical.
Yes. So for reals, I need to choose one representation of reals in Koch. I could use the axiomatized mathematical representation, for instance. But if I choose... computational reals, then of course there are things that I won't be able to prove.
Reals are hard.
Okay, so Chantal is visiting for the week, so if you want more time to get into the details, contact us. And let's thank her again.